Today we'll be discussing the fantastically beautiful exhibition, Black is Beautiful, The Photography of Kwame Brathwaite. We have this gorgeous book from Aperture downstairs in our store. Please buy it. And we are very lucky and grateful to have both contributors to the catalog, Dr. Deborah Willis and Dr. Tanisha C. Ford, with us today, as well as Kwame Samori Brathwaite and moderator Marc Bamuthi Joseph. I will give you their introductions and then turn it over to them. Kwame S. Brathwaite, son of photographer Kwame Brathwaite, is the director of the Kwame Brathwaite Archive, through which he manages his father's photographic archive and collaborative projects that are concordant with the themes of his father's work, namely activism, politics, fashion, and music. Kwame Samori authored a chapter entitled Fashion and Consciousness in the book Mod New York, Fashion Takes a Trip, and has lectured at numerous institutions, including Museum of the City of New York, Cal State Fullerton, and Harvard Art Museum. He co-curated Celebrity in the Everyday at Philip Martin Gallery, along with Jesse Williams, and curated Black is Beautiful, the Photography of Kwame Brathwaite, a touring exhibition in partnership with Aperture Foundation, which, if you don't know, is upstairs. So hopefully everybody knows that. The exhibition is currently on view at the Museum of the African Diaspora and will travel to Columbia Museum of Art and the New York Historical Society this year. He is also a real estate professional, graduated from Amherst College in 1996 with a BA in Law, Jurisprudence and Social Thought, and an MBA from USC's Marshall School of Business in 2018. He lives and works in Pasadena, California with his wife, Robynn, and three children, Jackson, Carter, and Kennedy. Deborah Willis, PhD, is a university professor and chair of the Department of Photography and Imaging at the Tisch School of Arts at the New York University, where she teaches courses on photography and imaging, iconicity, and cultural histories visualizing the Black body, women, and gender. Her research examines photography's multifaceted histories, visual culture, the photographic history, contemporary women's photographers, and migration. She is the author of Posing Beauty, African American Images from the 1890s to the Present, and co-author of The Black Female Body, A Photographic History, and Michelle Obama, The First Lady in Photographs. Both titles are NAACP Image Award winners. She has appeared and consulted on media projects, including documentary films such as Through a Lens Darkly and Question Bridge, Black Males, a transmedia project, which received the ICP Infinity Award 2015. And next we have Tanisha C. Ford. She is an award-winning writer, cultural critic, and historian. She's the author of Liberated Threads, Black Women's Style and the Global Politics of Soul, and Dressed in Dreams, A Black Girl's Love Letter to the Power of Fashion, and co-author of Kwame Brathwaite, Black is Beautiful. Ford's public writing and cultural commentary have been featured in The Atlantic, The New York Times, Elle, and The Root. She is professor of history at the Graduate Center, CUNY. And moderating today's discussion, we have formerly of the Bay Area, got him back here for a day. Oh, still of the Bay Area, pretending that he's on the East Coast.
Exactly.
Marc Bamuthi Joseph is a 2017 TED Global Fellow, an inaugural recipient of the Guggenheim Social Practice Initiative, and an honoree of the United States Artists Rockefeller Fellowship. In pursuit of affirmations of Black life in the public realm, he co-founded the Life is Living Festival for Youth Speaks and created the installation Black Joy in the Hour of Chaos for Creative Time. Joseph's opera libretto, We Shall Not Be Moved, was named one of 2017's best classical music performances by the New York Times. Formerly the chief of program and pedagogy at YBCA in San Francisco, Bamuthi currently serves as the vice president and artistic director of social impact at the Kennedy Center. Please join me in welcoming this amazing panel.
A one, two. All right. Sweet. Good afternoon. Come on, family. We're gonna have to do way better on our energetic reciprocity. Okay? Sweet. Pretty amazing people here. Gonna try to do this efficiently, deeply, and just let your brilliance and soul shine through, like Coming to America. Okay, some of y'all got that. So I would like to begin as a means of introduction by talking about a belief-centered definition of aesthetics. So by that I mean that aesthetics are what a people believe to be good, beautiful, and true. We can debate that, but for now, let's just use that as an operating definition. Aesthetics, what a people believe to be good, beautiful, and true. As a means of introducing yourself and bringing your voice into the room this afternoon, I'm wondering if you each could talk for a little bit about those four things. One, who are your people?
I need notepad.
Maybe. I got pen, I got extra, I got like a bill, the back of a bill that you can use. Who are your people? What do your people believe to be good? What do your people believe to be good? What do your people believe to be beautiful? What do they believe to be true? Kwame, you want to start us off? Who are your people?
Sure, thank you. You are my people. actually, no, it's funny. This entire panel, thank you for being here. Thank you for the interest in the work and for what's happening, both with, as we bring this out, the Black is Beautiful movement and kind of tell the story about this, but also for your time. Time is the one thing we can't get back, so thank you for that. Marc and I went to high school together, which is a really wild, wild thing. Like, I used to spend the night at his house, so this is like family. And it's the first time we're getting a chance to work together, so it's really beautiful. And then, you know, there are connections all throughout this panel. So to start that off, I mean, my people are, you know, my father, again, immigrants, right? Barbados. My father's parents are both from Barbados. They are Brathwaite and Maloney's. Have a history of activism, actually. I found this out. There's a half-brother who's in the Barbados kind of like Hall of Fame for doing his part in activism. There's this notion of they're entrepreneurs. My grandfather on my father's side owned a tailor shop and a dry cleaners in Harlem. So throughout this kind of what we're doing and the work that he did, there was this notion of this entrepreneurial spirit and this coming to kind of create something. My uncle Ilambe, graphic artist, my uncle Johnny, graphic artist, and then my mother on their side, my grandfather was, you know, he was a worker. He worked nights. So there's this history of work, this kind of thing that we talk about, like this kind of sweat equity. But I think when you think about these aspects of like what is and what we've looked at and what I've been taught to look at is beautiful is the notion of being yourself, right? This notion of accepting who you are. My grandfather on my father's side was also an artist, so he would take them out and they would kind of do art together. So there's this notion of all these things kind of coming together, and it ended up being kind of the path that my father took. So I think just to kind of start us off, those are my people. They are immigrant entrepreneurs who loved art and who believed in themselves.
Beautiful. It's really amazing question. Thank you for introducing that, because of course I had to write it down just to think about, like, who are your people? There's a collective in terms of growing up. I'm from North Philly, and that's special when you're from North Philly, you know, and the whole aspect of it. My father was a tailor. He had a tailor shop. And he also was a photographer, part-time photographer. My mom had a beauty shop. And so growing up in North Philly, it was a central place called The Village. And my father knew joy. My mother's family knew joy. So we had 13 brothers and sisters on my mother's side. 12 brothers and sisters on my father's side. I had 50 first cousins growing up. So we had a great time our entire life with just pure joy in terms of great grandfather as a Mason, spending a lot of time going back and forth Virginia. My mom's family is 98 today, 2 weeks ago, no, last week. So she's just amazing and, you know, having a great time enjoying her first great grandchild. And so just having all of these moments. But one of the things that we grew up in the Baptist church and the focus on identity and how you viewed yourself was central when walking out the house. Growing up in a beauty shop, I would listen as a kid to women talk about their relationships, their time, their work. So work was not necessarily labor, because I never heard them complaining about the discrimination they had, the difficulties they had. They talked about their excitement about going out on Friday night, Saturday night, getting ready for church on Sunday. So in defining that, I found storytelling as a central way for me to enjoy growing up in the environment that I grew up in. Yeah. And then fast forward, moving into teaching, I always focused on the idea of what happens with my students and what stories they want to tell. And I want to acknowledge one of my students today, Sam Soon, who is who's in the audience and and just happy that she decided to go to CCA. But looking at her family photographs related to my family photographs, also with grandmother and dress and style. And one of the aspects that I really appreciate is growing up in Philly is understanding your identity and not being ashamed of who we are as a people.
Again, I want to echo some of what's already been said in terms of I'm just so glad to be here, grateful to be here, to share space with people who I've admired from afar, some up close. And then also just to be in the space of this museum. I remember the first time I visited here, I felt like I was home. And that all leads me to say, who are my people? First and foremost, my people are Black people. And I'm rooting for everybody Black. And when I say that, I mean Black, culturally Black, but also politically Black. People who put the needs and the interests of the Black community at the forefront, who center us in what we need in order to be whole, what we need in order to prosper, what we need to in order to do more than just survive, to thrive. So, but what I've also learned as a scholar and a thinker is something from Robynn Kelly and Tiffany Ruby Patterson, who wrote this article that I first encountered in graduate school, where they describe diaspora as always in process, right? So the diaspora is always being formed. So it means I'm always discovering something new about my people and our culture, our history, our social ties, our religious and spiritual cosmologies. And it also means that as I've learned more about folks in the diaspora, I've learned more about myself and where I come from, a people that I had tried to flee for many years. I'm from Fort Wayne, Indiana, and as a young Black girl, I hated being from there. It was so rough to be just a stone's throw from the heart of the Ku Klux Klan country in southern Indiana, and I felt so stifled creatively, most prominently. But in recent years, I've turned very much to that exact community in order to discover what I think is beautiful and what I know to be true. And I was able to do a lot of that very deep emotional work, my book, Dressed in Dreams. And what it did in part was help take me to an early memory of how I learned what was beautiful, and that was thinking back about my mother, thinking back to when she would dress me in this Black is Beautiful t-shirt in the early 1980s, and she was draping me in a politic and letting me know that I was beautiful, not in the ways that the magazines were telling people that they were beautiful, but that my soul was beautiful. and that my soul was connected to a people with a beautiful past, a beautiful present, and a beautiful future, and that I could be empowered to do that kind of world building and community building that I would want to see happen for my community, that I was indeed an Afrofuturist in that way. So beauty and truth and people for me all kind of come together in that t-shirt.
Yeah, dog. Could you answer that question?
So much
as well?
Fun. Oh, can I answer that question? My people, I what resonates for me in a lot of what you all have said, but Tanisha, what you were just talking about, is that there's an aesthetic and then there's a politic. That there's a genetic reality, and then there's a political reality. And I am a first-generation American of Haitian descent. My people are immigrants. I am claiming America in a different way in my adulthood. I am also connecting to diaspora in a different way in adulthood. So my people are immigrants. My people work. My people are striving. My people are, my family are loud, but they're quiet dancers. This is my blood family. meaning like, you know, once Gentleman Jack steps out, we loud, but subtle dancers, not super loud on the dance floor. My extended family, my people, get high off of movement. I feel like if I haven't been with you on a dance floor at some point in my life, then we not people. So I'll stop there. And we will talk a little bit about, I think, sweat equity in a little bit, and just kind of the currency of labor in a little bit, because I think that there's a really potent and dynamic relationship between labor and the still image. So we'll move there. I just want to take this question of aesthetics and belief one step further, if that's okay, and just ask you all about, specifically about your work and your, in your life and your work, how do aesthetics function as belief system for you? Does that make sense?
So obviously, you know, Elizabeth mentioned this before. So my life is kind of split up into these kind of two factors, right? There's this, you know, the real estate startup person where I'm kind of running around doing corporate America work. But then there's this passion project, which is the work of my father, and being a good steward for the archive. So for me, this foray into the art world has been an introduction and a re-education in some parts to what I believe is beautiful, right? There's the notion that, obviously, I think his work is beautiful, right? Obviously, I wouldn't be, I'm doing this because there's a belief in what he has presented, right? These themes of acceptance, of empowerment, of truth, being one's natural self and bringing that whole self to the table. But ultimately, you know, there's the framework of his work, right? So there's the portraiture, there's the kind of political, there's the fashion, there's the pop culture that his work all encompasses. And so there's that aspect, but in also coming to this art world, I've been introduced to so many different artists and the work that they're doing and the things that matter to them. So my concept of beauty has expanded quite a bit. I did not know this world, and so I had to kind of get a quick education into it and start to kind of really sit. One of the better conversations that I had was with Hank, who's Dr. Willis's son, who is an amazing creator, and just sitting with him and spending some time with him to kind of understand his practice and how he approaches work. And there's so much beauty, there's so much, there's so many statements in his work, right? And so the thing that I like to do is then kind of go into, get to know people, because ultimately I'm really a people person, as many of you probably know. It's part of what drives me. So their notions of beauty have kind of, I've kind of incorporated it, kind of like, you know, like a basketball player kind of incorporates people's moves. Like I'm taking that all in and kind of absorbing it and kind of understanding the world in a different way, and the way that in which we kind of perceive what beauty is and what matters. And so it's expanding, and I think it's continually growing for me.
Focusing on the idea of an aesthetic, it's diverse and varied for me. And so when I think of, when you mentioned Robynn Kelly, there's an essay that I have my students read every semester, and it starts with Love, Study, Struggle. And that's an essay where he says that there are three words pinned on his desk, and that's, you know, love and study and struggle. Love your people, love your work, study, and understand the struggle. For me, was a central way for, as a teacher, to think about how do we think about belief systems, and how do we think and change missing and look for missing narratives that need to be explored. So I, as a photographer, studied at the Philadelphia College of Art, and there were no black photographers in the 1970s in our history books. And I felt that there was, that something was missing. And having a teacher who would say, you know, well, do the research, you know, find them and incorporate it as a term paper, which ended up being most of my life, because I spent, as a young artist who wanted to go into the archive, and I actually went into the archives at Schomburg and other places, finding images of black photographers and creating a new archive. And how do we think about Ebony and Jet magazine, and thinking about how do we explore the idea of how John Johnson and other black publishers use the aesthetic of black and understanding how do you expand the beauty of black. When we think about the magazines that I visited and read and the stories about black people, like Jet magazine, it all expanded the aspect of the color of blackness and highlighted blackness. Black, the Ebony, Jet, and their magazines called Tan and Bronze and Sepia. So growing up with all of those titles, we were always celebrating our blackness through the storytelling when we turned those pages, but also looking at the fashions in that. So when I think about that aspect of aesthetics, I'm thinking about believing in self, and that was a central way for me moving into my art and then becoming a researcher and then writing about photography, which I was determined once when I received my master's degree, just happened to be walking down a corridor that I've never walked down in Pratt, and there was a sign on this this corner wall that said archivist, photo specialist at the Schomburg Center, and I'm like, that's my job, you know, and it was my job, and it was the 1980, and I'll never forget that experience, because I was at Schomburg in the 70s doing research and saying we need to pull these images here, we need to change these titles here, give label to it, and then I'm so happy that Soul was going to be here, because I met Ellis Hazlip then, and Ellis Hazlip was my mentor. You know, just knew what I needed. I met your dad in 1969 when I was just kind of like 10 years old, maybe. I was at the County Cullen Library, and there was Queen Mother Moore was there, and your father was photographing her. Wow. And I'm like in this bath and in this community of black aesthetics, and And I walked up to him and said, you know, I'm a photographer. I really would like to meet you. I'd like to talk to you. He was embracing. And that was transformative for me, you know, just having that experience.
Deb, you model love so well. You love your people and you love on your people very actively. You set a model for so many of us. I've watched just how you've nurtured so many young careers, including my own, and I appreciate you for that. And just to continue with that thread of the Schomburg, I mean, Kwame at this point has heard me tell the story a million times, but back when I was a dissertator, I was doing some research at the Schomburg, and it was actually an archivist there who introduced me to Kwame Brathwaite's photos, his photography, and she said, if you're interested in blackness and beauty politics and politics and aesthetics and soul, you have to take a look at these photos. And I looked at them and they really transformed my research and how I was thinking about the Black Freedom Movement and the iconography of that movement. Because a lot of those photos that were collected in the archive were photos of protests, they're photos of Marcus Garvey Day in the early 1960s in Harlem. And those were in stark contrast with some of the images of protests and at the March on Washington in the same time period. But it was also at that moment too where I was finding pictures of members of SNCC, Dory Ladner and her sister Joyce, and they were wearing denim overalls at the March on Washington, and that too didn't align with the Sunday's Best language that we had been given to understand the politics of that movement for Black freedom in the early 1960s. And so I started piecing these things together, and I said, wow, not only are Black women kind of transgressing the beauty norms and notions of propriety of the day, they are using it to create a political language. They are also using it as an epistemology or a way of knowing, a way of thinking about Blackness, a way of embodying Black freedom. And that became very central to the work that I was doing. So I was able to map this genealogy of Black women who were using language that the beauty industry perhaps had been lauding, but excluding Black women, and particularly Black women with thicker features, fuller features, darker complexions, and natural hair, when they used that language. And they were taking that up as a way to imagine what freedom could look like and how freedom would be adorned. And for me, those became like the central threads of the dissertation that would eventually become the book, Liberated Threads. And I was able to map my mother in that genealogy and talk about her presence at Indiana University in the early 1970s and how she's using photographs of Angela Davis, her posters hanging up in my mom's dorm room, and she has the ubiquitous beads that are hanging in the 70s from every ceiling or doorway. She sewed, and so she made her own bedspread and pillows in the colors of the Pan-African Liberation flag. So my mom's own iconography from her college years were part of this longer trajectory where Black women had been using photography as a kind of insurgent technology, as a way to communicate these messages about beauty and fashion that was as much political as it was aesthetics in terms of something to look at and see and evaluate visually. It was something that they were using as a political language. So I've kind of played around with that over the course of my career and, you know, now trying to take it in new directions, but that's where it came from, those early photos in the Schomburg, finding photos of Joyce and Dory Ladner and other women who were part of SNCC in the early 1960s.
This is a really profound experience, just being able to sit with you all and to be nurtured in this way holistically. I'm wondering if we could all just take a few minutes just to gaze at the images that are cycling through.
This is one of my favorite images of you know, just the whole idea of music. It was so central to growing up in my family with hundreds of albums, but also men who appreciate women, women who appreciate themselves, and that little black dress that all of our aunts and my mom had, and that they had, you know, the Cuban heel, and this is a little higher. But, you know, the Afro with style and understanding that, and then the power of, you know, like, I'm ignoring you, but I know you're watching me, you know. So I really love it. And then, you know, as we, you know, go through our moments of, you know, protest here with this whole aspect of the wig, here Kwame is like documenting these many stories of what happens when the, you know, the Parisian style wig and what happens in that community. So where women are questioning. But I love the fashion. I love, you know, their bodies and understanding what's going on.
Yeah, that was one of the first. Can you go back to that one, Kwame, or the one? That was one of the first ones I found in the archive. It was this protest photo. And I was like, wow, these also ran in the Amsterdam News in New York, the same time period where they were covering the protest. And so I kind of followed the coverage of the protest in the black press of the time. But like you said, those when I was finding these photographs, and then I'd already found the album covers where, you know, he was collaborating with Blue Note Records, some of those musicians who had been part of the jazz shows that A-Jazz was putting on, and then they were, he went on to design the covers, working in conjunction with Miles Reed, I think that's his name, Miles Reed or Reed Miles, one of the two, but he was the creative director at Blue Note at the time, and so I started to look at those album covers and say, like, wow, okay, the women who I'm now seeing in the archive at the Schomburg are also on these jazz album covers. So I was trying to piece together, you know, this whole history. And then this one in particular, this is Black Rose, right? Yeah. So Black Rose, before she even joined the Grandassa model, she was an activist and a barber and hairstylist. She's also a very important political thinker who is often erased from the discourse around Black intellectual history and Black radical thought. She was writing in Liberator magazine pieces about Black women and their hair politics and whether or not Black women, particularly Black women who are part of the Black nationalist community, had a responsibility to wear their hair natural. And so I thought it was interesting that not only is she resisting his gaze, she's looking at a magazine with the Grandassa models in it, right? So her mind is on Blackness, right? She's thinking about the Black African feminine, right? Mm-hmm. While he's focusing on her, her mind is on other things. And I think it was really important for me to kind of piece together that these women weren't just models. They weren't just, again, they weren't just women who were posing for a camera. They were women mm-hmm. with their own political ideologies. Mm-hmm. So that was key for me, but also the pleasure of looking at these photos. I mean, these are fun to look at as well. They capture a certain kind of Black cool that I think I is lovely to see.
Mm-hmm. And it was really exciting for me as a curator, you know, starting to collect these works during the time and meeting the Black photographers in the community and getting them in to the collection was really exciting.
Kwame, speaking of Black cool, can you talk a little bit about what's happening here?
Yeah, so this is pretty funny. This just happened, and I had to ask permission to use this. So this image is actually in the exhibition. It's an image of my mother. That's Genesis Dean Swiss Beats and Alicia Keys' son. So they've actually started to collect the work, and he posted this video yesterday of Genesis just enjoying himself. And so I actually took clips of it, but if you go on and you go and follow Swiss Beats on Instagram, it's like this wonderful video of he's like, okay, let's go, and he runs and he slides, and it's just this joyful kind of just Black joy at its kind of essence. And so I texted Swiss and was like, hey, can I throw this in the conversation? I threw your name in there. He was like, okay. But, you know, just this kind of space where, you know, you have play and you have art, you know, coming together in this really magnificent space. So it was a really good illustration of kind of Black joy in that way. And so I just wanted to show that. But, you know, these are some of the images that we were able to work with Aperture to kind of pull forth. And, you know, these images are in the book for the most part. And the book is the kind of catalog in which the exhibition upstairs is based upon. And so there's an extension of this. I also added some of the more current and popular images that you might recognize, of people that you might recognize, just to kind of demonstrate. But this is that same protest, the Wigs Parisian protest. And it's interesting because you have, you know, the juxtaposition of Noomsa in the first one that you saw of my aunt Noomsa, with the sign on protesting, but then you had, you know, there was this really kind of pushback within the community, right? Beauty is personal, you know? Mm-hmm. Decide for yourself. If it looks good, wear it. You know, try a wig and see, right? And so, you know, there are these, and this still exists, right, in our community, where there are these choices. But I think the thing that's really key for what was happening then was there wasn't the option to wear your hair natural and be considered beautiful. And I think what they did was create the space where that could be a possibility. So.
Can we stop right there?
Yeah.
That man.
I'll go right there, yeah.
Well, actually, we could keep going. That really is the thing. But
yeah.
One of the reasons why I wanted to talk about sweat, labor, struggle, is as a performing artist for a long time, I fully believed that sweat was part of my aesthetic. Not only because I happen to sweat a lot, but also because it is evidence of labor, it is evidence of transformation. Sweat is chemical. I did a performance in Boston this past May or June, and I'd injured myself. And this was a performance that we could not cancel. It was a series of performances that we could not cancel with Arts Emerson. And for the first time in a long time, I could not dance. So I had to
Wait, hold on. That's a really big statement, because as I said to you before, I've known Marc since, you know, actually elementary school. And Marc is dance, right? Mm-hmm. So that I just want to put it in context. I'm sorry, continue.
Right on. At the very least, I move around a lot. I move around a lot. And I'm a writer who embodies language in a physical way. And I'd like to think that part of the dramaturgy of my work actually is the evidence of labor in the work. But being a little older and not being able to move as much and being faced with a particular reality around literally the value of my work if it wasn't embodied, I started to struggle with my own sense of aesthetic, of personal aesthetic. In other words, what is the value of my work if it's not sweating? So, James Brown. And the hardest working man in show business, please, 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 James Brown. But I would like to contrast that image or many of these images with that understanding of the value of sweat, because so many of these images are mad cool. That image of your mom,
right,
that Genesis is playing in front of, is mad cool. That green, the iconic orange that we're, you know, just as backdrops, just what they do, the capturing of cool. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that contrast, each of you, between how it is that we are able to portray the value of the black body as cool and not necessarily the black body in struggle or in labor or in the midst of sweat.
Can you put that image back up of James Brown?
Yes.
When I first saw this image, just thinking about the idea of the designer for this outfit, this jacket, this check jacket, with the way that his pants, his look, the handkerchief, I can't remember what you call the men's jacket there, the idea of what it means to be cool. When he's on stage, he's fully dressed, and we know that the heat's going to rise. So having that experience and with his hair well coiffed, you know, in that sense, that he's working this. And the way that Kwame photographed him, for me, I know we have different levels, and he has some images of him on the same level on stage, but the way that he kind of lionizes him and the way this pose, this gesture. So we as viewers, 20, 50, 60 years later, we still feel that movement. We still feel his pressure in his hands. We still feel him from inside, that he is, you know, about to belt out something, that he has that experience. So you have that song? So that's what I see that. And that aspect of cool, you know, in terms of pure masculinity, you know, understanding what it means to perform, understanding the importance of that audience, wherever they are, they're there to hear him, and he is there to perform. And having the photographer understand the importance of documenting this was really important, that gesture that I see there.
Yeah, I think in this image too, this is one of my favorites from his work thus far. The thing that was really interesting for me with this one, again, is this pose, right? This, he, you know, legs are tense, like he looks like something amazing is happening and is about to happen, right? It's like the moment right before, right? And the thing that I think is relevant to the work that my father did was, you know, the way that Ajaz started was through their love of music, right? And so this notion of understanding music really well, but also understanding where the pregnant pauses are, when the crescendo is happening, all of those things and the nature of the music and the way it builds, that played a role in the way that he, you know, used his camera. So, you know, you have to remember, and some of you are a little younger in the room, this is the time of film photography, right? So you couldn't just snap an image and think maybe I got it, right? There was a timing aspect of a lot of the work, right? He was trying to get that moment, right? He was looking for the moments, and he talks about it even in the intro to the book. Like, there are these special moments where you get them or you miss them, right? And there's no going back. There's no do that over, right? Especially as you're in this point, you know, when you're documenting, right? There's that in the studio, right? It's highly controlled. But when you're documenting and when you're trying to capture these special moments, there's this aspect of, okay, understanding. And so I think that is why he's able to capture that cool, right? That sense of cool, right? There's this notion that, okay, how do I present this person in their best light, right? How do I put them out there? And I think in the tone of a lot of this work that you see now, there's this sense of regality, right? There's this sense of power and this sense of, you know, being proud of who you are. And so I think that carries throughout this work that we're looking at now. I think it carries throughout the way in which he always wanted to portray people in their very best light. You know, he told me a story one time about Michael Jackson had committed that he was gonna come and do a photo shoot, a studio shoot, but he had like kind of an acne breakout and some, you know, the vitiligo and stuff like that. And he still came. And he still sat for the pictures because he had committed to doing that, and they had that relationship. But my father committed to never showing the pictures, right? So just the thought of taking a picture and knowing that you'll never show it, there's something special there in that relationship. And so I came upon those negatives, and I said, okay, this goes into this will never be shown, right? And so you have to honor that. And so there's this aspect of respect, but also this aspect of like, how can I make sure that we present these people in the best way? And I think that aspect of cool, the cool of jazz, that is inherent in the way in which he started his career, and it flowed throughout. And so I think that's the core of it.
Yeah, the theorist in me really likes thinking about this question of sweat and cool and labor, and because all those words have so many meanings. But it definitely makes me think of another story that Kwame shared with me, Kwame Sr., when I first had the opportunity to interview him for the Aperture profile that I ended up writing on him. And it was about, as Kwame mentioned, they would recruit these jazz musicians for their shows, and they started to build relationships with them. And one of the people that he was able to build a relationship with was John Coltrane. And he tells a story of hanging at Coltrane's house on his day off, right? and seeing the jazz man outside of his suit, which, like for James Brown, the suit, that's the sign that you're ready to work, right? That you're gonna break a sweat, right? You got on your work clothes, right? In this case, it just happens to be, you know, some spats and a suit and a tie, you know, but those were the work clothes. So to see the jazz man outside of the clothes of labor, and he's, you know, just in his t-shirt, and he's playing the sax just around the house, and Kwame is capturing those photos of cool on its day off. Mm-hmm. You know, that to me, I mean, do we have to, if you find those in the archive, can those be made public? Yeah. I mean, because after just hearing that story, you know, and so I, as a writer then, I'm listening to him tell me this story, and I'm trying to, I feel my own as I'm sitting in front of my computer and I'm trying to compose, like, how am I gonna let this unfold on the page? I'm trying to, you know, call up Coltrane's music in my mind. I'm trying to, I find my own body swaying as I'm trying to find the, how can I find the cool? Like, this is my own labor practice, trying to take what he told me and put that on the page with a certain kind of rhythm, mm-hmm. so that it dances and moves on the page in a way. And you know, that was a skill that grad school didn't teach me. You know, it didn't teach me, how do you translate that, you know? And how do you take things like work and labor and sweat and like try to tell that in a beautiful story, you know, for people to make them understand something about the art form and something about the jazz impulse that is inherent and imperative in Kwame Brathwaite's work.
It's stunning because, you know, as Kwame talks about how we grew up together and we've known each other more than 30 years, you know, this cat was just Kwame's pops. Like, he was just Kwame's dad. Just like, you know, like your friend's dad. Like, okay. You know, he's cool, but just someone I refer to as Mr. and was scared of because he was somebody's dad. You know what I'm saying? Like, loved, revered, but scared of because he's somebody's dad. You know? And the way that I've been able to be reintroduced to your father, and the way that I'm kind of retroactively playing out my childhood through this proximity, like, you want to talk about meta? This is a moment to truly appreciate how close to the work, how close to you, and to also honor you for uplifting the work, forwarding it, making sure that the work not only surfaces in terms of collective memory, but also the hyper-present. I do want to talk about collective memory and the relationship of memory to music. As a means of prefacing, I'd like to just read something from Ta-Nehisi Coates. My son wants to FaceTime. Not now, kid. Sorry. I mean, we could. But I was able to perform this stage version, this adaptation of Ta-Nehisi's work, Between the World and Me, and so got a little closer to some words that I'd like to use as a way of taking us to the dance floor. And what'll happen is we're gonna listen to some music together, talk about the relationship of music to these images, to collective memory, and then we'll open it up for folks in that are listening that haven't verbally participated in the conversation yet to come into the convo, okay? That's how the next, like, 30 minutes will go. Cool? Sweet. So this is Ta-Nehisi Coates. He says, "Son, I think back to our trip to homecoming. I think back to the warm blast rolling over us. We were at the football game. We were sitting in the bleachers with old friends and their children, caring for neither fumbles nor first downs. I remember looking toward the goalpost, watching a pack of alumni cheerleaders so enamored with Howard University that they donned their colors and took out their old uniforms just a little so they'd fit. I remember them dancing. They'd shake, freeze, shake again. And when the crowd yelled, 'Do it, do it, do it,' a black woman two rows in front of me in her tightest jeans stood and shook as though she wasn't somebody's mama. I remember walking down to the tailgate party without you. I could not bring you, but I have no problem telling you what I saw. The entire diaspora around me, hustlers, lawyers, kappas, busters, doctors, barbers, deltas, drunkards, geeks, and nerds. The DJ hollered into the music. The young folks pushed toward him. A young man pulled out a bottle of cognac and twisted the cap. A girl with him smiled, tilted her head back, imbibed, laughed. I felt myself disappearing into all of their bodies. The birthmark of damnation faded, and I could feel the weight of my arms, hear the heave in my breath. And I wasn't talking then because there was no point. There was a moment, a joyous moment beyond the dream, a moment imbued by a power more gorgeous than any voting rights bill. This power, this black power, originates in a view of the American galaxy taken from a dark and essential planet. Black power is the dungeon side view of Monticello, which is to say the view taken in struggle. And black power births a kind of understanding that illuminates all the galaxies in their truest colors. Even the dreamers feel it, for it is Billy they reach for in sadness. And Mobb Deep is what they holler in boldness. And Isley they hum in love. And Dre they yell in revelry. And Aretha is the last sound they hear before dying. We've made something down here. We've taken the one-drop rules of dreamers and flipped them. They made us into a race. We made ourselves into a people. Ta-Nehisi Coates. So, Dre, Aretha, Mobb Deep, Isley, and what those names do for us, just the mention of the names and what they do for us, the way that music serves as a kind of indexing of our collective experience. So Kwame made a playlist, and the playlist has all kinds of significance for various reasons. And I'd like to play a couple of songs and just have you three respond, if that's cool. So, yes, good job. So song number one. Can we turn it up a little bit?
That is hands down my favorite Bob song of all time. You know, redemption song. You know, he's talking about the middle passage, and he's talking about, you know, how we triumphed through that. Bob was a very important person for my father. He credits Bob with the kind of being the key to his access to others in that realm. He said he had, when people saw him with Bob, who did not allow a lot of people around him, that opened a door. But he said, if Bob trusts him, then we trust him, right? And so it opened the doors for him to be able to then go into other aspects, to be at home with Bob, to be at home with John Coltrane, to be with Miles, to be with Stevie and Muhammad Ali and those people. And it was a really, it set the stage for him to, that really opened up his access, that level of trust that was there. And you know, if you look at who those people were at that particular point in time, as far as spreading the message of black is beautiful and black love and empowerment, they were the influencers, right? That was the influencer of that time, and they still are. And the Grandasses and Ajaz became influencers as they built kind of knowledge. But, you know, Abby Lincoln was the person who would go ahead and when she was, Abby and Max Roach would talk about A-Jazz when they were going on tour and they were talking about the albums that they were coming out with. They made sure people understood who they were. And then, you know, for me, you know, it took a while for me to appreciate Bob the way I do today. My father, who loved him dearly, you know, when I was younger, I only saw my father cry twice, and that was when his mother passed away and when Bob passed away. So that he meant that much to him, and that was the music that played in our house. I mean, he woke me up every morning. I did not like this growing up, but he woke me up every morning to get up, stand up. So that was how I had to get up in the morning. And so I kind of was annoyed at that, but as I got older and really started to get into his music and the lyrics and what he was talking about, Bob became a very important person in my life as well. So that's why Bob's on that list.
I love that song too, and I think about your father as, you know, I'm, you know, 20 years old meeting this man who created a space for freedom where, you know, I didn't know that who he was in terms of, but I saw the idea that he went against John Johnson, you know, in terms of the ideal models. Colorism was really a point at that time, and there were only certain types of models that were getting into Ebony magazine, but they were in other magazines. But your father and that song, in terms of that notion of redemption song, I see that connection in creating a space for freedom and that message that your father offered those of us who were looking for different models, not just types, but models, to emulate, and that I think that that's a great song to emulate and create that connection to redemption in that way.
Yeah, all right. Maybe I have time for two more.
Jackson 5, can I start with this?
Yeah.
Because I remember seeing Motown 25, that special Motown 25. This is, so I wasn't very close to the African American experience probably until the late 80s. My experience growing up, at least in my immediate household and a lot of my friends, was the immigrant transition to African America. So there was, I watched my parents struggle to begin to articulate a black identity within the context of being in New York, being in this country. So the music that was playing in our house was a lot, you know, we listened to Haitian music in the house. And, you know, as the technology made it such that I could, you know, buy cassette singles, I could buy albums, this kind of thing. But I remember my dad bought a VHS, a VCR home. That was the shit. And he bought the VCR home, and one morning, this is before third grade, one morning he says, "You got to see something." And he plays me this performance that he'd recorded the night before. And it's the Jacksons performing this medley of music, ending with Michael Jackson performing Billie Jean on his own and doing that moonwalk. Right, right. I was in third grade. I'm crying now, dog. Yeah, I lost my mind. But they sang this as part of that performance. This is one of the songs, and I remember feeling different. I think one of the reasons why I want to play this music is not only because your father's work is so connected to music, right, that conversation is going on, but again, not really understanding what I was looking at as a child, and now understanding that your father's work literally is Black history, that it is a way for us to understand the last half century in Black culture in a way that feels not like a memory, but feels present. It feels alive in a different kind of way. The way that song, those first couple of notes, will always bring that feeling back for me. The way that music brings us, music intersects past and present. And I wonder if you guys could just talk a little bit about that relationship between the indexing of our history through the still image and the indexing of our history through music.
Yeah, I mean, I think one thing I think about when I listen to that Jackson 5 song and being of someone as Kwame Brathwaite is of the jazz generation, being someone from the hip hop generation, I just can't help but think about sampling and the power of the remix and how so many of the Jackson 5 songs and the songs in Michael Jackson's catalog also have been sampled by folks of the hip hop generation, you know, and so that becomes a way for certain sonic traditions to live on and different genres of music, but that come from the same root. And so I think what's interesting now is, especially now that Kwame Brathwaite's images are starting to circulate, particularly online through social media, we're starting to see a remix of his aesthetic, right? People sampling the aesthetic, you know? And so, I mean, I think a prime example, Alicia Keys recently posted images from her new album cover art. And she says, like, hey, this is, you know, I was inspired by these photographs. And it's her by 60 by 60 photographs that are Kwame Brathwaite's work. And so I'm really thinking about what Craig Werner calls this jazz impulse or the blues impulse. And for him, he's thinking about how Black writers who are writing in the modern period, right, how they are taking the spirit of jazz music, and that's imbued in the writings of a Langston Hughes and other people of his generation who are writing. And so I think that we can see how a similar musical impulse can be tied to photography as well. And so we can see the jazz influence, that jazz impulse in Kwame Brathwaite's photography, but then we can also see how hip hop artists are pulling on the R&B impulse from groups like the Jackson 5, and we see that living through the hip hop, but also how hip hop generation people are wanting that to live through photography as well. So just thinking about the relationship between art and photography and using sampling as a way to see some of those connections.
Yeah, I follow that in terms of just the imaginary. Mm-hmm. When we hear that song, I'm, you know, embraced with what it means to be there, yeah, you know, and what he says, you know, I'll be there. And this is a kid singing. This is a young people singing this song. But what it means is to be present, yeah, you know? And that's what I see with this work. His work was present into our lives, and that's that connection to the music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it you know, it is. It's a combination of the words. It's the connection with the Jackson 5. He actually went with them on their first trip to Africa. And so he went with them to Gori Island and took them to places so that they and kind of talked to them about their experience, right? And so was actually an article that I found recently that he had written about the whole thing. This is also around the time that he changed his name from, he went by Ronnie, and changed his name to Kwame, because that's when he was, you know, starting to engage with Kwame Nkrumah and different political leaders, and he was so impressed by Kwame Nkrumah, he changed his name to Kwame and named me Kwame. So there was this notion of that connection with the Jackson Five, but I think for me it is, it's the presence, right? The I'll be there, like, and it's funny because when oftentimes people will contact me and say, hey, we're looking for images from an archive, and you know, I'm still going through it, so I it's kind of tough for me sometimes to say I haven't found that yet, but people say, you know, if anybody was there, he was your dad, right? He was seemingly everywhere at all times. You know, to the it was like, did he clone himself? Because there was a point where, you know, even in 1974, so in 1974 he went to he took the Jacksons to Africa. And it was the Rumble in the Jungle was that same year. That was the year he was at the concert in Jamaica with Stevie Wonder and Bob Marley. That's the year I was born. My mother's actually on the cover of Essence, pregnant with me, May 1974. He took the cover. Susan Taylor asked him my mother to be on it. So it's actually the month that I'm born, May 74, and she's like pregnant with me on the cover, and it's like this crazy kind of thing. But I was like, he was everywhere at all times, and so that notion that he would, you know, if there was something that was happening that was important within the culture, he would be there.
That's fascinating, because we've all traveled to be here today from different places, and we were talking a little bit about the commute. But to bring it back to our elders, to bring it back to our ancestors, how can you not hustle? How can you not, you know, seeing the evidence of what they've done? Mm-hmm. That omnipresence, it wasn't an omnipresence, it was just the desire to do a thing and to get and to do whatever it is that you had to do a thing, which... because culture is omnipresent, we do what we need to in order to be present, literally for the culture. So, being mindful of time, I want to make sure that we take the next few moments to open up the conversation. For those of you who have been here the whole time, you've had an understanding of kind of the trajectory or the arc of the convo. For those of you that have joined us late, mostly it's just dope people talking about dope images. For real. But I wonder if there's a provocation or a particular feeling, a question that somebody that hasn't spoken yet has been wrestling with, either about the work directly, the exhibition, the Black is Beautiful exhibition, or just, you know, a personal question, a personal professional question for one of the folks at this table. There's a hand in the back. Yes, ma'am. There are two, one and then two.
Where about?
I'm sorry?
Where?
In Kenya.
Oh, nice. Okay.
Yeah, so the women emulated the women in those pictures. But can you speak a little bit perhaps about your dad's, you know, sort of Pan-African influence?
Yes. You know, at the core of the work, you know, and actually there was an article that came out in talking about the exhibition and kind of speaking about how some of the contemporaries of that time didn't see actually the Black is Beautiful. That they were worried about the way it had been co-opted kind of for commercialism, which it's still being done today. So I think actually Ms. Morris and Ms. Sanchez both alluded to kind of Black is Beautiful taking on this different kind of turn from the phrase and what it meant. And at the core of his work was always this activism, right? So, you know, there are these images that represent it and kind of talked about being yourself and being natural and being yourself naturally and beautiful as you are and embracing your, you know, ancestral qualities and characteristics aesthetically. But at the core of the work was this, the Pan-Africanism, which was, you know, they were Garveyites, they followed Carlos Cooks. They were my uncle, my father, and Ajaz, as well as the Grandasses, because they were on even playing field. They were all equals, and talking about how they could bridge the gap between Africa and the rest of the diaspora. So it was important for them to kind of do the work that was part of that, the labor. When a lot of these countries that were not recognized at the UN but had an opportunity to speak, they would meet them at the UN, bring them to Harlem and say, come talk to the people about what's going on in your country. Talk about what's happening and how can we support you coming both directions, right? Coming back to Kenya, coming back to Nigeria, to Namibia, to the countries. And in turn, what ended up happening is they ended up helping multiple African nations gain their independence. So Sam Nyoma was the first president of Namibia. Namibia was instrumental in the end of apartheid, and that they were the bordering country, and Fidel Castro supplied the weaponry and the ammunitions to fight in the war against apartheid to Namibia. They were with Sam Nyoma, with the current president, President Hygob, back in the 60s, doing the work to kind of create this Pan-African community in supporting each other. And so there was the notion of these images going out to support that. One of the women, Brenda Deaver, who is a Grandassa models, had become this kind of vision of Nigerian. She was like the Nigerian standard of beauty, this woman from Harlem who was a Grandassa. So there was this creation of a community, but a global community, in touching, you know, both in the States, in the diaspora, and embracing, because you're thinking about a time, this is essentially 1956, early 50s and 60s, Black people are still calling themselves Negro, but they're calling themselves African, to bridge that connection. So there was always that core portion of their work that a lot of people didn't see. In fact, I was talking to my cousin, Sinke, not too long ago, and you know, my uncle Alambe was this, you know, he was the brainchild of this Pan-Africanist movement. In fact, the southwest corner of 125th Street is now named Alambe Brathwaite because of all the work he was doing in the community, and that's directly across from Thelma at the Studio Museum. So it was this really interesting thing, and you know, it's down the street from the Apollo where their Ajaz offices were and where my father took a lot of these images. So there was this sense of community, but this Pan-Africanism, but it was funny because a lot of people didn't know. So I was saying my cousin Sinke, he said he was with Dapper Dan, and Dapper Dan was in Harlem, and he said, what's this business about, you know, Kwame and Alambe doing the Black is Beautiful? That was Cecil and Ronnie. And I was like, yeah, he was like, no, they changed their names, right? And so this, he was like, oh, okay, So it was this understanding, and even people today, because my uncle shortened his name to Brath, and my father kept Brathwaite, my uncle said he was tired of waiting for shit, like, people didn't even make the connection that they were brothers, right? And so the people knew. The people who were part of the struggle and, you know, December 12th movement and some of the other Patrice Lumumba coalition, those are all the part of their struggle. And you know, I used to have to go and sit in some of those meetings when I was young. I wasn't so happy about it at first. But, you know, it kind of informed my kind of world knowledge about what was going on both here and abroad. So.
But I want to follow up with that because when I wrote my second book on Black photographers, Kwame, I met with him to, I had wanted some images from his collection, but he wanted me to have the images that focus on Pan-Africanism. And I wanted the women and the other story. He says, no, I want you to put Thomas Sankara in this, in your book. And unfortunately, he was killed like the next year or within a short period of time. But he wanted my book to include images of Pan-African men and women, specifically in Africa, who were changing the narrative from the experience of Jomo Kenyatta when that story to this 1980s way of thinking. And it was really amazing because, you know, I didn't want to struggle with him about it, but he really wanted that image, which is one of the most important images. And he said to me, I'm so glad that that book has that image of Thomas Sankara. So it's really important to think about his notion of what he knew it was important.
Yeah, actually, they were the ones that brought Nelson Mandela to Harlem when he came to speak, when he was released from prison. So it's at the core of his work. The other time I've seen him get emotional is when he talks about the end of apartheid. Mm. And de Klerk having to turn the country over to Nelson Mandela. So we're enjoying some of the more, you know, aesthetically beautiful images and the beautiful artwork. No, at the core, it's all about that. And you know, even when Elizabeth introduced, like, the projects that I do, I try to make sure they embody that spirit, right? That spirit of doing the work that he would have done, making the choices that he would have made, so that we're not, you know, watering things down.
I'm glad you told that story about Dapper Dan, because, I mean, imagine my confusion as a researcher. I'm like, okay, at certain points, I have some of his writing in there, Kwame and Ilambe at that point, but then I'm also seeing them in, like, Muhammad Speaks, like old issues of Muhammad Speaks, the Nation of Islam publication, and they're Cecil and Ronnie, and I don't, at least Dap knew them. I didn't even know which one was which, like, which one's the photographer, which one, you know? So I was like, okay, let me just roll the dice and hope I get this part right, you know? But I'm glad that you also pointed out Brenda Deaver, because there was a publication called Flamingo. And when I was, again, having never spoken to anyone in the family, I'm trying to triangulate as best as I can and locate these people in the archive. I have the album cover art. I have the photographs in the Schomburg. But I'm in London doing work for another chapter on Black Power in the UK. And one of the archivists over there say, hey, look at these. And it's old issues of Flamingo magazine. And I find Brenda Deaver on the cover of Flamingo, which was a publication that was produced in the UK and then distributed across the British Caribbean. And also then they launched a Nigerian issue. And then so in May 1965, Brenda Deaver is on the cover of the Nigerian issue of Flamingo. And then also in an earlier, like probably in the early 1960s, a man, I think his name is Herbert Monica Thierry, I apologize if I'm butchering his name, but he is a publisher who owned like 11 or so different newspapers and magazines in East Africa. I think at the time it was then Rhodesia. But he comes to Kwame Brathwaite and asks for some of the photos of the Grandassa models, and they run on some of his magazines. I think we tried to find one of them. Is it Parade magazine? We tried to find one of the issues, and I believe it's in the book. But Abby Lincoln was in that magazine. The Grandassa models were on several different covers. So there's a way that these women, oh, there it is. There's a way that, is that your Aunt Noomsa? Yeah, so there's a way that these images and that aesthetic with the single colored background are traveling throughout like the black print media of the diaspora, representing a visual Pan-Africanism.
One, and then two, and then three.
Mm-hmm. So great to be here, thank you so much. Clara asked one of my questions that I had for you.
No, those are great. Okay, creative process. I think I alluded to it earlier. You know, this is film. So a lot of what you're looking at are 2.25 negatives that are medium format. He, you know, he had a studio at, you know, he had the AJS studio at one point. He had studio, I remember it was on like 57th Street. I remember Melba Moore was in the building. It was like a big deal. But his creative process was really, he wanted full control. He was a true artist. He wanted full control over the process. So he would develop film in our bathroom at home growing up. Like, there was no going to the bathroom at night because I flipped the light on, turn that light off, right? So he would develop in, you know, he would be there with the chemicals and working with them and developing the film himself. Then he would cut it and he would hang it. And, you know, I remember the little weights at the bottom to make sure the film didn't curl up, hanging from the shower curtain. And then he would go into the lab and he would print. And the thing that I really enjoyed was the summer when I was 16, I decided that I was like, let's figure out this whole photography thing. So he's like, why don't you be my apprentice this summer? And I said, yeah, I happily agreed. And as you probably have a different experience with him because, you know, you were another photographer and a creator. My experience, and Mark can allude to this, my dad didn't speak, he didn't talk a lot. Like, he was kind of, he let his camera do the talking. And so my general interactions with him when I was younger were like, hey, you do your homework? Yes, okay, go to bed. Like, it was, you know, it was, they were kind of quick and they were curt. I knew we cared. Even the birds and the bees conversation. You know what that's about? All right, cool. it was very succinct. But I think it was really interesting because that summer we would spend a lot of time in the dark room. And that for me was this really cathartic place. It was a place of like meditation and like there was, you know, this his artistry, and I got to see that in action, which was really amazing for me. And so, you know, it'd be pretty quiet. We'd be in there like 8 or 10 hours, you know, in the dark room, and he'd be printing stuff. And then all of a sudden he'd be like, come here, let me show you something. And he would, you know, he would start to put in the developer and watch it. And for me, that's the process that I started to fall in love with, like watching those images emerge from that, the bath and the developer, and seeing that piece of paper then turn into something, this beautiful image, was really amazing. And then the way that he, like, you know, when he would get into the enlarger and he would print and he would, like, you know, use his hands to kind of shade different areas, and the whole thing, that process for me was where I started to fall in love with photography. And in fact, I almost got my MFA when I graduated, but the thing that stopped me was, you know, I didn't have the access that he had, and this was right when digital was starting to come out. So that's one. And then for the grandasses and sustaining themselves, it was really amazing because, you know, they're creating their own clothes. Carol Lee Prince, who was a designer, the beautiful image of my mother with the beaded head wrap on the cover of the book, she designed that. She designed jewelry, and I was, but she was also doing it specifically for people. So if she designed a piece for Dr. Willis, she would design something else for Dr. Ford. So it was very specific to the person, but then also a lot of these women, as they started to create their own fashions and threads, then what would happen was other people were like, hey, can you make something for me? So it created this, you know, self-sustaining economic kind of within the community, which, you know, fosters the whole Buy Black, right? So there was a lot of that. You know, Black Rose had her own hair studio, and she was teaching people how to take care of their naturals, right? Because at that time, a lot of people didn't know how. And she was getting so much spillover, she talked about this, she actually was sending them to other people, right? And teaching them how, in other salons, how to take care of natural hair, because that was what was happening. And she was saying she had celebrity clients from like New York Knicks to like the Jets and the Giants, and they would come there to make sure that they were, you know, they had their stuff tight. So it was part of it. But I think, Tanisha, we were talking about something recently when we were in London. Can you talk a little bit about the grandasses and like that? No, oh, the story with my mom.
Oh, yeah, definitely. So it's also important to note too that when Kwame and his brother form AJAZZ, I mean, these are folks who are teenagers. So a lot of the grandasses are younger women too, teenagers, early 20s. Some of them are in, you know, participating in Grand Dasas, like before they go off to college or in their early, their first years of college. And so then sometimes as I interviewed some of them, they talked about how they, you know, you kind of aged out, so to speak. Some of them went on to get married and have children, so they weren't necessarily doing the modeling thing. But what also emerged from those interviews, we met at one of Kwame's friends' houses in New York City, and we kicked the men out. And then the women, we just sat around, and I finally got to interview these women who I'd seen on these images for so many years at this point, been living with the project. And what they told me was that sewing clothes, they're making their own clothes, that was really central to the sisterhood that they shared and their politics as a modeling troupe. So Kwame's mom tells this story about how she came to, you know, she came to her first Grand Dasa meeting, and she's decked out in her little designer clothes from some European designer. And so she comes strutting in, and they're like, oh, that's nice. Did you make it? And she's like, no. And, right? And so immediately they're like, oh, you know, not really impressed by that, you know? And so she's like, I had to go out and find a used sewing machine so that I could learn how to make my own clothes, because that was part of it. It was Black women designing from an African-centered perspective, designing clothes that accentuated and celebrated their curvy bodies. This wasn't no Twiggy, because the model Twiggy was, you know, a global sensation at this time. But they're sewing against and designing against that body aesthetic, right? And so they're, so you had to learn how to sew your own clothes, even if you weren't as good as somebody like Noomsa, who was just a beast with the sewing machine. I mean, her designs, I still would want to wear a lot of those things today. You still had to learn how to do something, how to make something. And so I think about this as I watched my mom sew when I was growing up, and seeing the designs that my mom made for herself when she was a college student. And I've been thinking about how Black women use sewing machines to stitch their own sartorial dreams into existence. Wow. You know, and that for the Grand Dasas, that was, again, like the sewing, the clothing was a part of the political message. It was a part of the political ideology.
Curious, how did your parents meet?
So my mom tells a story that, so she's significantly younger than him. And she lived in Harlem about a block and a half away from one of his, my grandfather, his father's tailor shop. And, you know, they would be out, you know, on 125th Street, kind of talking about the liberation. And she remembers seeing him and being like, he is the most brilliant man I think I've ever met in my life. And so she started, you know, this is when she's like, you know, in her teens and coming of age. And so she started like being like, I want to be a part of that group, right? I want to be a part of those Grand Dasas. And I guess she had gone to be, you know, interview and kind of be a part of the Grand Dasas. And, you know, they had conversations, and that turned quickly into, hey, you know, let's hang out and have coffee. And so that was, it was really her desire to kind of like be within that, this, you know, forward-thinking group of people. But she said she just remembers him speaking and just really impressing her. And she's always been about education, and she, you know, she went and got her master's, and she was an educator. And so that was her thing. She was like, wow, this man is just incredible. And the things that he's saying and these notions and these ideas were just incredible. So it was that. And he, you know, quickly, as she was, she was his muse, she quickly, he quickly, you know, took to her.
we have time for these last two questions. One of them, sir, yeah.
Mark, I love how you started thesis of having them talk about aesthetics, and which is, you know, like a third rail for the scholars, I'm sure, especially. And this is a question for the scholars. So much of conversation is about beauty, not as a form of the plural, but that's what your scholarship seems to be about. How do you, can you talk a little bit about the struggles you have in your careers around making that kind of articulation?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's always been, when I was in school, you couldn't talk about beauty. You know, beauty was, you know, like, just not important, and not talking about black beauty was not even a part of the discussion. When I decided to do the research on black photographers and look at the communities that they were photographing, I was also comparing what white photographers were photographing on black communities, and it didn't reference what black photographers were looking at. And so they were reflecting the notion of pride, the notion of sustainability. All of these experiences were not part of the narrative, that the breadth of black experiences. So when I decided to just kind of look at these images, create a pile of images that I wanted to explore later about not only the struggle, but also about black love. And in 2000, I was diagnosed with cancer and realized that having that cancer, you know, diagnosis, how many people didn't want to be near me because of the whole notion of beauty and illness? And I decided that I was going to write a book on what not to say to people when you're sick or when you look like you, you know, like about to slip off the side of the world. Even though everyone else has these different experiences about it, so it was like personal and scholarly and academic, I wanted to explore that question of how do we look at life as beautiful? And that's what I wanted to explore with the images that I had stacked aside, which started with the black female body in photography, looking at the images that tourists and travel photographers made in the 1890s and of black people in Africa, then comparing to the kind of noble images that black women, club women made about their activities as organizers, to images of artists who were creating images about their experiences as resistance. So they were all the kind of narratives I wanted to explore through just having that diagnosis. So I thought, you know, probably I had 3 years to live, and I wanted to make sure that I spent the next, you know, 3 years compiling images and making sure that I had the story that was missing in the 70s in books, and that's what I wanted to explore.
That's a really good question. I think, fortunately for me, I finished grad school in 2011, and that's when I then started thinking about taking this dissertation that had looked at these different forms of soul. I was kind of using a hip-hop approach. If hip-hop has 5 or 6, depending on who you ask, elements, I was trying to think about what are the elements of soul culture. And I had this thing, and I was trying to transform it into a book around 2011, 2012. But fortunately for me, people like Deb Willis and Maxine Leeds Craig and Noliwe Rooks had kind of already charted some of that territory when it came to beauty and politicizing beauty and having us ask deep intellectual questions about the nature of black beauty, how it shows up in the flesh, the politics of natural hair. Tiffany Gill was another one of those people, Ingrid Banks. And they're doing it from an interdisciplinary approach and often with a black feminist root. So that for me, I was able to build upon that work that existed. I think the battlefield for me was when I dared to use the language of fashion, right? Yeah. That's where the Academy was like, oh, fashion. Like, you know, like, what is this? Like, of course, you know, within fashion institutes and other art institutes like Pratt and Parsons and FIT, you know, that there is a long tradition of studying fashion theory and fashion history, but I wasn't proposing to do that. You know, I was trying to think about how could we, you know, think about fashion and how it shows up in the everyday, like the politics for women who are on the front lines of the movement. What are they thinking about when they go show up at a movement? How are they choosing their attire? How does that become a political language that circulates around the diaspora? But that was the point where there was this sticking point. And especially because
you know, I show up to work like this, you know, and I don't have, you know, the elbow patches. I'm not a white man. I don't have the little nerdy glasses. And it's like, you know, how are you going to be an intellectual authority in a classroom, but you look like Janelle Monáe, right? You know, so that was always the battleground. And I went to one of my mentors, Tiffany Gill, and, you know, she said, Tanisha, if you are going to do this work, which I encourage you to do, you have to make sure that your methodology is sound, that it's unassailable, that, you know, so along the way, I took that note and I tried to create a way, a method, a way to do this work. And like my intellectual foremothers, whom I've mentioned, have done for me, I wanted to be able to create a path that other younger scholars could tread upon, that they could do this work, and for them, you know, fashion wouldn't be the other F word. There was this dirty word in the academy. And so that's been the work that I've committed to doing, is engaging with fashion as a political language, thinking about overlapping terms like dress and style. And so a project like Kwame Brathwaite, Black is Beautiful, really spoke to my intentions as a scholar activist, if you will, because I wanted to make those connections, but within the academy, but also outside of it, to find new ways to tell our stories, to find new ways to engage young people and to make them interested in history and in Black and African diasporic histories more broadly. So that's been the work. Sometimes it feels, I'll be honest, it feels kind of stifling, because then people just say, oh, she's the fashion lady, right? She's the one who, you know, talks about fashion and wears a bold lip color, you know? And but it's like, actually, I feel like I do so much more than that. I study Black migration. I study, you know, Black feminist theory. I'm writing cultural theory. I, you know, am a, you know, a researcher who researches in archives around the world. Like, those are the kind of things that I think kind of mark my work, but sometimes the fashion label becomes just slightly reductive. But if I have to fight that battle so that other people don't have to fight that same battle, then I'm happy to do it.
And that's 5 minutes. I'm going to have to leave because I have to get to the airport. But it's a significant way of entering into the things that you're bringing together. We think of the time. We have, you know, not post-civil rights. It's part of that civil rights movement activism. We have Vietnam going on at the same time. That's happening where young men are dying in Vietnam, even before we knew that the war was, it was a conflict then, and that it was a war. There were drugs going on in Harlem at that same time, and then gangs going on in that time. So Kwame and both, and your uncle was a poet. I mean, this is the way that he was able to incorporate the language of power. How do we empower our communities? They were fighting against all of that at the same time through creating concerts, bringing people to fashion shows, introducing theater to people from middle school to college and beyond. So when you talk about having a community that you wanted to introduce beauty as a form to of a discussion, they were doing that, you know, on every level, ground level, in introducing that way of changing names in not only streets, but changing that community. Langston was still alive at that time. So the friendships of writers of from the Renaissance, they were still living in the Harlem community. They were painters. So the two brothers were bringing all of these people together in different ways, and having the still camera and video camera and the archive of their posters. If you see that image of the posters that they created, that enlivened people to want to be a part of the movement of empowering themselves. So that's where their voices were known for me as a young artist interested in that community and seeing that change. So I'm gonna thank you all. And then slip out.
Yeah, we're respectfully, I think that we could probably just end right there. Yeah. In terms of the public sharing, we have a little bit of time, and they're apparently strawberries and water and cheese and whatnot, but and wine,
and of course, if you haven't had an opportunity to go upstairs and see the exhibition, yeah, the video's a poor replica, but yeah, go upstairs and check out the exhibition. I'll be around for a little bit if you want to ask questions and. Yeah, thank you.
So thank you to the Museum of the African Diaspora for having us. You. This is Kwame Brathwaite, Dr. Deborah Willis, Dr. Tanisha C. Ford. My name is Marc Bamuthi Joseph. Peace. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.